This is Erica. And, she's been away for a little while, and she's my wife of 17 years. We just celebrated the anniversary.
2 days ago.
Yeah, that's right. I have my topping points so that I don't get off track here.
We are married.
Yeah, that's right. Erica's a mom to our children, Sean and Elijah, and you're multi-gifted. So Erica's been away at St. Andrew's Church being their worship, their kind of contemporary worship leader,
helper,
coordinator, whatever you want to call it. And lately, she's actually become the interim pastor just for the summertime at a church in Thornbury, a Free Methodist church. So we've been getting a little bit of preaching experience. Erica's actually preached in more churches than I have over the last year. So that's fun. Erica's taking a preaching course at the end of this month. She's wrapping up her MTS. Pretty well, it is wrapped up almost. And you are the wisest person I know.
You're kidding.
No, I was thinking, what am I going to say? So, there's an introduction. Let me pray, and then we'll hand it over to Erica. Father, thanks for Erica. And Lord, what a treat it is for me and for this congregation to be able to hear from her this morning. And Lord, I pray that you would that you would speak to each of us, and that you would speak to her, and that the words would be clear, and your message would be clear to each of us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Last week I preached on the wisdom woman, and I thought I would modify that for this week so that I can let you in on what I've been up to over the past year or two, maybe more. So today I want to bring you scripture and my testimony and something from others, all wrapped up into one. Right now, Jason and I are ministering in three churches between the two of us. Finishing up ministries, saying goodbye. A couple weeks ago, I had a convocation ceremony to celebrate graduating my Master's of Theological Studies, and it was a beautiful ritual. I didn't commemorate my first degree with a convocation, so it was important to go and to do this one. St. Andrew's wrapped up for me last week. I'll no longer be with them on Sunday mornings, but they've asked if I would continue to work with their worship team during the week. So I go to the practice and I encourage them. And sometimes I feel like I'm a bit more of a worship team chaplain than a musician, but it's been so good. And we're preparing to say goodbye to you. And that's started happening over the past 2 weeks. And it takes some time to say goodbye and to have face-to-face conversations with you. So as we follow Jesus, we've had some experience following Jesus through brambly bushes, forests, and it feels like now we're standing facing this wide open highway of unknown, and there's the horizon off in the distance. We're on a pilgrimage to a holy place. I think that's what life is like. Part of that new venture is that we'll be in Thornbury in the summer, and they've called me to be their interim pastor all by myself, and they're just a lovely, small community. It's a Free Methodist church, and they have warmly welcomed me, and they have a desire to reach out to their community, and they are in the search process right now for their permanent pastor, and so that's really an exciting time for them. So, it's good to be able to reflect with you. I made a note to myself this morning to make sure that I have some Kleenexes. Because it's kind of a hello sermon, but it's also a goodbye sermon. And I hate to cry. Oh, I hate it. But it's probably going to happen. So, I'm warning you ahead of time. I'm okay. So, Proverbs 8, the wisdom woman. Would you pray with me, and we'll just ask God to join us. Lord, you are already here, and you are out in the world, and you are everywhere. But we call you right now to come and work in our minds and in our hearts. Would you be the ongoing revelation of the Spirit to reveal new things to us, to me, as I stand here and prepare to testify to the work that you have done in my life and around me. Pray that the scriptures that we open would illuminate our minds, that your light would shine in the dark places of our lives. Speak now, we pray. Amen. So the wisdom woman, Eugene Peterson calls her the wisdom in his translation. And I just think it's lovely. Who is she? She's cosmic. You can turn in your pew Bible, I'm going to use that one too, to Proverbs 8. So it's just basically in the middle. If you see Psalms, Proverbs comes right after that. And I'll read from verse 22. Proverbs 8:22. The Lord formed me from the beginning. This is wisdom talking. Before he created anything else, I was appointed in ages past, at the very first, before the earth began. I was born before the oceans were created, before the springs bubbled forth their waters, before the mountains were formed, before the hills, I was born. Before he had made the earth and fields and the first handfuls of soil, I was there when he established the heavens, when he drew the horizon on the oceans. I was there when he set the clouds above, when he established springs deep in the earth. I was there when he set the limits of the seas so they would not spread beyond their boundaries. When he marked off the earth's foundations, I was the architect at his side. I love how the Hebrew scriptures uses a feminine pronoun for wisdom, who was with God, part of God, at the beginning. And in the Greek, the word for wisdom is Sophia. And I think it's important to hang on to the feminine pronoun here and the word here, because we don't have very many female images for God. But we are created in God, male and female. We are created in his image, male and female. Sophia, wisdom. So does that bring to mind John 1:1? Does that bring to mind Genesis 1:1? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, God created the world by the word. Wisdom. When we hear the word is daka, the word for scripture, the authored literal words in the Bible. And then John calls Jesus the word, the logos, the interpretation, the fulfillment, the everything of the word of scripture. So when we hear in Proverbs, get wisdom, we should also hear, get Jesus. Yet the fulfillment, Jesus brings it all to mind, makes us wise through his spirit. I've known since I was 5 years old that I'm called to ministry. We're all called to ministry. Jesus, when he comes into our life and reveals who he is, calls each one of us to fulfill his plans for our life. But I can remember where I was, and what I was doing, and how I felt when I was 5. Feeling like, Lord Jesus, you have called me, and you have a plan for me, and I will follow you. I grew up in the missionary church. The very first church I was part of was Wilmot Center in New Hamburg. And then when I was 5 years old, we went to Faith Missionary Church in Kitchener. And there were some wonderful people along the way who encouraged me and called me into roles of leadership. I had a good, good mother. And the words of Jesus and the name of Jesus and the teachings of the scriptures were always on her lips. Mothers have a critical, important role in passing on the faith to their children. Charles Wesley and John Wesley talk about their mother, Susanna, who they considered one of the first women scholars and teachers in their life and in the Pietist movement of which we are part. She passed on a strong faith to them. So I thought that my options growing up were to be a missionary. And I thought I could be a pastor's wife and do ministry that way. I came to realize I could be a worship leader. Then I came to realize I could be a chaplain. And then I met Jason. And I don't know if you know this, but it was totally, like, in the moment that I first met Jason, there was, like, this revelation from the heavens of, that's the guy for you. He's the one. This is it. And I knew that we would get married, and I knew very shortly after that he's my soulmate, and I still believe that to this day, 90% of the time. There are a few moments. But when I found out, or when I realized that actually Jason was serious about feeling called to be a pastor, I really struggled with that because I felt like, what's that going to mean for my calling that I think I have? Are you sure you don't want to do cross-cultural missions? Really? He's pretty sure that's not what God's calling him to do. So I knew that I was going to struggle. And I married him anyway. But my message for you moms this Mother's Day is that Jesus is wisdom. And Jesus brought freedom and responsibility for women too. Jesus exalts and lifts up the most unlikely people. So moms, what is your unique calling? What has God created you for? What brings you life? You've probably heard of Little Whisper of It since you were little. I really struggled in the mom of little ones phase. I was very discontent. And I thought, because I know this book, that discontentment was sin. And I thought that if I could find contentment, then I would find God's peace and happiness. No matter what I'm doing, like Paul says, I can be content in all things. The thing is that I tried for years. And I've also cried a lot. And I remember the day sitting in the Hanover Rec Complex watching our kids in the pool swimming. And it was probably one of those angst-filled days, which were so common. And I looked at Jason and I said, why aren't you encouraging me to go back to school? Why aren't you encouraging me to live out the calling that God has planted in my heart? As if somehow he was the gatekeeper of what God was calling me to do. As if I needed his permission to step out and be the person God has created me to be. So it's like, it kind of went like this. And I think it caught him off guard because he went, yeah, go back to school. Go tomorrow. I'll help you sign up. We'll go get another vehicle. Is that what you're needing? I was pushing and saying, read my mind. And he was like, yeah, go. And so going back to school has been amazing. I've learned to understand how to interpret the scriptures just a little more. I don't think any of us really gets it fully. I think that's part of being wise, is realizing what we don't know. To be able to engage and wrestle and understand a little bit about this book means that it speaks into what matters into my daily life. It's no longer, Jesus, thank you for saving me. Perfect. See you in heaven. It's actually, this book is full of wisdom and practical help, and the word comes alive. Jesus walks with us and talks with us now, giving us wisdom, helping us to interpret what is good and fair and common sense. Because if we seek, we will find. If we knock, he will answer. And if we ask, it will be given to us. It's only in the last year that I've realized God is calling me to be a pastor. And after being a witness to what it means to be a pastor for 17 years, since the day we got married, I'm not sure that I have it in me. So am I making it up? Is it just really awesome, fun, full of accolades? And I thought God doesn't call women into lead pastor roles. But I do have confidence in what the Spirit is saying to me, and that other people are affirming me, and that doors are opening, and that my husband, the one who knows pastoral ministry and me and the voice of Jesus so well, is coming alongside to encourage. Because wisdom is dancing with the mind of God and people, creating, explaining, navigating the tensions. I'm going to go to verse 30. I was the architect at his side. I was his constant delight, rejoicing always in his presence. And how happy I was with the world he created, how I rejoiced with the human family. God's mind into our mind, through the Spirit, through the Word. It's good to be encouraged. St. Andrew's in their bulletin has a little section every week that says, send a card to someone in the congregation. And you put the person's address in, and the name, and I got so many cards this past week from them, and I just feel uplifted, and what a lovely, simple gesture. I encourage you to consider that. HMC sent me a lovely card that said, congratulations on your graduation. It was so nice to be warmly remembered. So part of this realization that I think God's calling me to be a pastor is a little bit strange, because I thought that Jason and I would be pastors together in the same church, in the same congregation. And that seemed to feel safe, and that seemed to feel right. But what's happening is Jason's own calling is growing and changing alongside of mine. And God is leading us both into one strange step after another. So, where's our obedience leading us? How do we recognize the wisdom of Jesus? And Proverbs tells us how we recognize. Asking. What is common sense? What is fair? What is righteous? What is good? What runs from evil? And I don't know that my calling's in the missionary church. And HMC is one of the few who have affirmed women in ordination. Lindsay, blessings on you for following Jesus into difficult places. And so I feel some grief and some lament of letting go of my long-time, lifelong faith family, but I trust Jesus. And I hear a lot of confusion from women when it comes to women as pastors. If you have two resumes on a desk, and one is a recent graduate with a bachelor's degree and 4 years of experience and is a man, and the other one is a recent graduate with a bachelor's degree and 4 years of experience and is a woman, would they both get an interview? What if the woman had more experience? Wisdom says, what is fair? G Jesus says, what is fair? The Bible has a long history of being used to oppress people. It's just true. It's historically the way it's gone. We can use the words of Scripture to make ourselves more powerful and oppress others. Slavery has been justified with Scripture. I'm pretty sure today, if you wanted to have a slave, you could open up the Bible and make a pretty good case for it. The Crusades have been justified with the Bible, and so has gender oppression. The message of the cross is freedom and responsibility. In studying the history of women leaders in the church, my undergraduate degree, as well as in religious studies, and Max Weber is a very prominent theorist, and he talks about the very prominent, very key role of women leaders historically. And it's interesting that in church planting and in missions, women have a key and important role and lead to church growth. When women are involved, the churches grow. When women are involved, new works get started prolifically. It is historical fact. And we see this in missions everywhere we look. And then what happens is, once the church becomes established, it becomes an institution. And when things are institutionalized, we get policies and paychecks. And that's when men take on leadership. So what happens if the church isn't hearing from women in the pulpit? When we don't talk about the household codes of the ancient Middle East that inform the writings of Paul. I feel like I'm an example of what happens. I'm 40 years old, almost. I've been called to ministry since I was 5, and I know it. And I had no idea until 6 months ago that God could call me to be a lead pastor. I don't want to communicate to my daughter that she should do all the labor, the relationship building, the visioning, and then hand over a finished product to a man because he can do a better job. Is that wise? Is that really how I'm going to interpret this word? Because it doesn't sound like common sense to me. It sounds like injustice and oppression. And I don't want to communicate to my children that God values men more than women, or that God will only use them in certain ways because of their gender. Because the Spirit is creative and alive and at work in men and women. And the prophet Joel cries out in the Old Testament, God will pour out his Spirit on men and women in the last days. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Joining Jesus in the dance of asking for wisdom and following the Spirit. Here I am, Lord. So while I began the process of recognizing my call to the formal ministry here at HMC, thank you. God has also called me into new territory to spread my wings. It, I think, had to happen. And I'm learning to be a minister as an equal, a helpmate to Jason, absolutely. And I think I've heard, and I know Jason feels like he is and he will be a helpmate to me. Because that word helpmate in Genesis, it's actually a balancing of the scales. It's a north pole and a south pole. So I kind of feel like I'm a bit homeless, as church families go. A sojourner, following Jesus to take risks that he's asking me to take. Seeking justice and sharing the abundant light that he has for us that means something every day. A professor of mine told a story about a pastor's, and this really hit me, a pastor's wife who felt called to ministry alongside of her husband. And she worked and she fulfilled her vocation, as a pastor's wife. And then something happened to her husband, and he could no longer minister anymore. And that meant she could no longer minister either. It's important to me to be able to stand alongside Jason and also as a whole individual. I don't want to be bound to rules. Do you feel like you're bound to rules? Do you jump to conclusions, mothers? Do you just think you know? Wisdom says, listen and learn. Recognize what you don't know. Be willing to be creative about what's going on. Jesus himself challenges the interpretation of the law. He walked around with, you know, the Torah. That's what he had in his mind. It was all memorized. He didn't have a New Testament. And when people would come and ask him, Jesus, how do you interpret this part of the Torah? He would challenge them often and say, it's okay to pick grain on the Sabbath. It's okay to eat the consecrated bread in the temple, because the law was made for us, to keep us safe, to put a fence around the things that might cause us danger. We were not created to fulfill this. The scriptures are alive. Jesus is alive and active and engaging with us. So mothers, give grace to your children and love them more than the rules. I'm so sorry, Shauna, because I think for the first many years of your life, I loved your obedience more than I loved you. Truthfully, I apologize. That was not wise, and I want to change that. I confess. I think that's how God feels about us. He loves us more than he loves our obedience. So, I'm on this journey of listening and learning. I really don't know so much. There's so much I do. Everything. I don't know anything. And I've learned a lot from you about patience, laughter, humility, forgiveness. And thank you for helping me to recognize my calling here, for opportunities to lead in worship and in other areas. I will look back on this place where I was loved and supported. A few years ago, I asked the board to write me a letter so that I could ask ENCC for some grant money to go back to school. And you wrote a lovely, affirming letter for me. And I was able to receive that grant to go on and continue learning. And I didn't realize then that that learning was going to snowball into ministry opportunities and being able to serve the larger church. So thank you for the written notes of encouragement over the years, the hugs, the affirmations, the surprise birthday parties. And most importantly, this is the most significant thing for me, thank you for loving our children. I'm sure you've heard the stereotypes about pastors' kids. It's scary to raise children in the church. It's incredible to see our children's love for you, that they want to come here every Sunday when they have options to go to other churches. They can come with me, but they don't. They choose to come here because you love them and they love you. And they call you their family. And that's a gift and a legacy that you will carry on in their lives and in the lives of our family forever. So, I'll invite the worship team. And I have a few questions for you. Are you encouraging the young girls among you to live into the fullness of whatever God is calling them to do? Are you loving people more than the rules and the regulations? Are you becoming wise and able to recognize what is wise? dancing with Jesus and the mind of God and the tensions that you face. Because we're all called, every single one of us, to bring the good news of abundant life to those around us through the transformational, living, holy, trustworthy word, Jesus Christ himself.
Father, would you send us forth from here as people of wisdom, as people who embrace the common sense, the good, the blessing that you are, Lord Jesus. And I pray that there would be young women set free. And I pray that there would be older women set free. And I pray that there would be everyone in between set free to pursue you and to abandon those laws that perhaps are of human origin, in order to embrace wholly and completely the things of the Spirit, the things that you are birthing within us, Lord Jesus. So send us forth from here to be agents of freedom, agents of reconciliation, agents of love, agents of grace, today and tomorrow.